I had a question ready. So I want seems a shorter time, let's cut all the bullshit out. Tell me what has gone on in your life to lead you to be, am I correct in saying, just coming back from doing a bunch of things in Afghanistan, one of which was snowboarding?
That's most of the way there, yeah. I didn't go snowboarding on this last trip, but essentially I have just come back from a self-funded trip to Afghanistan, which was spent mainly in the company of athletes in Kabul, which is kind of strange during the peace talks and the snow in the city, because obviously everything you hear about Kabul is just war zone, murder, death, kill, isn't it?
Yeah.
What led me to Afghanistan in the first place, to go there as a civvy?
Well, you tell me. Let's get to the point you're at now, cutting about London with loads of flipping meetings, ready for getting ready for whatever. You tell me. Hiatus Foundation.
Yes, yeah. Okay. Hiatus Foundation is something I'm in the process of creating now to get support for athletes that I feel are underrepresented. Hiatus itself is a word that mainly the Americans use, that it means like a gap or something that's missing. So the first thing that came to mind when I was thinking about ways that you can support athletes that have, you know, missing something, was that hiatus just seemed to feel like a natural fit. It is a word I've been banding around for a couple of years with like a personal blog of when I was leaving the Marines, how to get all the knowledge and experiences I was having at the time out to other people that could obviously benefit from it in a way like what you're doing with this podcast now.
Mm-hmm.
So how did I end up in Afghanistan? It's a very long story. Essentially, I never deployed to Afghanistan in the military, despite having been in for 12 years, and had a massive curiosity as to what the country looked like. So my brother spent about 13 years in the military, and he deployed there 3 times. Obviously being a bootneck, obviously the units I'd gone to, we'd either done preparation for going, or I'd done individual training to go out for roles, which subsequently changed. And so it was one of those career-defining thing subjects that, you know, you spend so much time preparing for, and everyone talks about it as such a defining thing during your career, that when you don't end up going with everyone else, you feel massive, like you've missed out on something. So it was, in a word, curiosity that took me out to Afghanistan the first time. The first time, and the second and third time.
So when did you get out?
Early 2016. So I'm in my third year of transition now, I'd say.
So tell me what that was like. You got out, and then how long before you got out and then went to Afghan?
I got out in, I was doing my transition in 2015, so yeah, sort of like summer 2015, I guess. I did had my first interactions with Team Rubicon, who obviously you've had Rich Sharp on here, and obviously you're a grey shirt volunteer as well.
I'm on my way to being a grey shirt. I'm in the military training, yeah.
Have you not got your grey shirt?
Yeah, I signed up, and then I've got my induction next. Pat, they've changed it now, they've changed the training now, so they do the induction and your domestic responder course in a one-er. So I've got that. By the end of April, I'll be sorted with that. But I digress. Yeah, I've had Paul Godonis on as well. He was a great show.
Yes, yeah. And he's a massive influence as well on the great show community, isn't he? He's done a lot for the organisation over the last couple of years. So 2015, I had my first interactions with Team Rubicon. I went to Nepal for 2 weeks later on in the year to do a shelter construction programme in Gorkha, which is where the epicentre of the earthquake was. And that gave me the... When I was in transition, that gave me the idea that I wanted to do something with purpose, and that in the same way that you're drawn to the military because it's not only a lifestyle, but it's something that brings purpose. I knew I wanted, from that point onwards, something that had the same thing. So I guess in transition, you start to look at a whole load of career streams, don't you? From if you imagine like everywhere from one end of the spectrum that is like business, you know, finance, and that's a, you know, quite a typical bootneck officer route, isn't it, into sort of like the financial sector. You've got everywhere in the middle, which is say management consultancy, you're less sort of capitalistic business, I'd say, and then all the way over to like the left hand edge of the spectrum, which is say like your hardline humanitarianism, charities, you know, low pay but high amount of meaning within your work. So kind of throughout that year of transition, I was trying to figure out whereabouts I would slot into this employment spectrum, and had the meetings early on with the people in finance, and knew that
Were you in working office, were you commissioned when you were in?
Yes, half my career was, yeah. Okay. So the first half of it was non-commissioned, and the second 6 years was commissioned.
Go on, sorry, I interrupted you.
Yeah, that's good. So, yeah, that time when I was trying to figure out what part of the sector I wanted to go into, my time with Team Rubicon helped confirm that I wanted to be in like the charity, NGO, something with a bit more purpose than, say, like hardline financial services. So I left that and had some more meetings and eventually got into the BBC as an advisor on the high-risk operations team. Did 6 months in New Broadcasting House in Oxford Circus, which is, I don't know if you know much about the BBC, but I've got a couple of thousand people there across 9 floors.
Oh, really?
It's a really cool, creative place to work. But in terms of someone who spent 12 years trying to avoid the office as much as possible, it's a real sort of cultural shock. You know, you're not surrounded by people who you can, you know, have real open relationships with. It, let's say, you know, you can openly swear and have very relaxed, isn't it? Exactly. Yeah.
Weird.
As soon as you go into the civilian employment sector, you become hyper aware of just how much slang and swear words you use on a daily basis.
And what you can get with, how different your perception of political correctness is. That office environment. I'm lucky where I work. I work with Paul.
Yeah.
I work with a lot of ex-military, it's about as loose an office environment as you can get, right? And is effing and blinding, and you know, it's not crazy, but you got a lot of civilians in there as well.
Yeah.
But they just sort of get on with it. The humor is a big one, though.
Yeah.
I know a person who shall not be named, right, as an example of this. Yeah, I don't know what it was like in the boot next, right, but when I was served with Power Edge, I am digressing here, sorry. But when I was in pre-power, we had very few colored, like, black guys in there. and I'm talking, when I say very few, in the 12 years I was there, or 11 and a half I was there with 3-power, I think at most at any one time we had in 3-power was maybe three. It was just the way it was. It wasn't through racial discrimination or anything like that. It's just the way it was. And I remember the banter. It was because most of them were good friends, you know. I'd be working close to a lot of them over that time. And one of them, our greeting in the morning would be, this is when I knew him in depot, and I say, morning, you bastard. And I would never the N word, though. That was like never, yeah. Right? But his reply would be, in his flipping Fijian accent, morning, Hugh, you Welsh. See you next Tuesday. I mean, laughing. That was it. You know, he's like, man, I know of a person, and he was at a party, a birthday party, and he got asked to take a photo of everyone, and it was all civilians, right? With one ex-military person, one other ex-military person there, yeah. And this guy had had a couple of drinks, right? And he turned around to take the photo, and so everyone's there, like all together to take this photo, and on the far limit of this gang of people was a black guy,
yeah.
And this guy cracked the joke. Oh, just want to make sure we've got everyone, and also we've got the token black person. Which in the barracks, mate, that would have been everyone like, "Hey!" and then the person would be slagging. It doesn't mean anything. Yeah, it's like a jab, right? Did not go down well. Did not go down well for this person at all, mate. Tumbleweed. Yeah. Accusations of racism, and it's like, my god. Yeah, he did not enjoy that, but it was also a regrettable incident for him. He learned from that one. I heard. Unbelievable. Honestly, you know, you know that person probably woke up next morning and thought, what on earth was I doing?
Yeah,
but yeah, that's transitioning into Civvy Street.
Yeah. Well, do you know what, I thought loads about this in that, you know, in the military, you've got this bond, haven't you, through shared adversity, whether that's basic training or, you know, just being in the same unit at the same time, getting getting the same shit details from up above, or, you know, getting seen off by, you know, we call it PASA, but, you know, getting seen off by the system. And it's what bonds you. And then if there's an issue, you trust all the people around you to rate. If there is an issue, they'll obviously tell you about it, won't they? It won't become a formal thing. It'll just be a, mate, you're like off the mark with that comment. Or, you know, you look after each other, don't you, in that respect.
Yeah.
You come out into the civilian employment and it's completely different, but you're still accustomed to the way it is in the military, aren't you? So I was the same in the BBC. And I know there's people which will definitely agree with me on this. It just felt like it took ages to get used to that kind of thing, you know, and that I know other people have experienced this as well, that you'd crack a funny, or what you think's a funny, no one laughs, and then a day or two later you get, Chris, can we just have a private chat?
Do you know what it is? No one wants to offend anyone. And that's what it is. They're really afraid of offending people and then having the book thrown in their face because of it.
Yeah.
That affects so many things.
Yeah.
From your business and personal, your business relationships in a personal manner, you know, how you get on with people. And it also affects how a business operates, because if someone's afraid to offend someone, they're afraid to tell them, you did that wrong.
Yeah.
They're also afraid to own up that they did something wrong.
And take responsibility for it.
Take responsibility and accountability, and there's no punishment. It's like, oh man, that's the biggest one. And again, that's not across the board. You know, it's just that, and that's just the massive difference in the cultures.
Yeah.
Civvy and military. Across, it's just the way it is. I'm not saying civvies are any worse than military, but, you know, it makes it hard to adapt.
Yeah, yeah. And for business as well, is that, you know, the business depends on, you know, profit and loss, doesn't it? So if you're an organization that doesn't learn anything because everyone's too frightened to say anything, then all that happens is you become irrelevant, don't you? And much more agile, better businesses overtake you, innovate better products faster because everyone feels like they can share their ideas, and you get left behind, don't you? Which is
absolutely,
you know, not good for anyone.
But are you on about BBC high risk?
Yes.
So, digress all the time.
So I was in the BBC high risk team, and I started off within a particular part of it where it's quite female heavy, and, you know, being used to, you know, spent the last 6 years in the Marines, you know, which is all blokes, and so obviously you get very comfortable just kind of speaking your mind. And
is it all blokes? Is it all blokes?
At the moment, I believe it is.
go on.
And it was a very strange situation. It was a very strange feeling because you felt like you constantly walk on eggshells, because you never really knew where you stood with other members of the team. You know, you could obviously build rapport. And I think the first thing that any of us people who have been in the military tried to do is go out there and build rapport with all of your other teammates, don't you? Because it's, you know, how much of a good environment it is when you get on with everyone around you. And if there's any conflict to be had, you get it done early so that everyone, you know, is much more friendly or working place, isn't it? But for the first 3 months working in this particular team, because I was part of the high risk team, but I seconded off to like another part of the organization that dealt with the international officers overseas, and there were times where sitting in the office in New Broadcasting House was pretty excruciating, because you didn't know if you're doing good or you're doing bad. You then got into this strange mindset where you were second guessing yourself. You know, you couldn't really take a particular stance on something because you didn't really know who would be there to support you or not. And this is not, again, not the high risk team I'm talking about. It's because they're all military. You know, if you've got a shit idea, they'll tell you you've got a shit idea. That was like almost like your insulation within the organization. But when I seconded off to this other part of it, you felt very vulnerable and out, you know, and exposed, you know, in that you could say, well, I don't think we should be doing this, or I think we need to take this seriously, and it almost felt like a roll of the dice as to, are people going to agree with me or disagree with me, and am I going to be shut down, am I going to get supported on this? It's kind of hard, and obviously when you're in the military, you're used to seeing, you're used to getting instant feedback, aren't you, like yay or nay, or, you know, especially if you're a troop commander or anyone in position of authority, if you give out, you know, if you say something that's very unpopular, then lads aren't afraid to tell you that it's a shit idea or it's a it's an unpopular decision, isn't it? So you get, when you're so used to that instant feedback, when it gets removed from you, it puts you on the back foot, makes you like less confident, I'd say.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, that, or certainly it did with me. Anyway.
I mean, just to elaborate on what you're talking about there with the, you don't know if you're going to get supported or you know who's going to back you up. That's not a, I mean, for people listening who are maybe, you know, about to get out, they haven't had much experience in, you know, ex-military, haven't had much experience in Civvy Street. So that's not about, correct me if I'm wrong, Chris, that's not about you thinking, oh, am I going to be, yeah, it's not about you needing that positive reinforcement. It's about, often you'll get an idea in business, you'll have an intention, but to get to the point where you need to, you can put it on the table and go, here's my idea, it takes a lot of work, a lot of work. So at the start, if you're questioning, can I put this across the table and get an honest feedback on it, not based on what it actually is and if it's actually worth it? And if the answer is, God, I don't know, should you put all that work in? That's what you're talking about, right?
Yeah, exactly. I remember there's one particular incident. So the Mosul dam collapse in 2016. I don't know how much about it you know, but essentially the Mosul dam, which holds a shit ton of water.
We know. I know what that is.
Yeah. So this dam was holding a shit ton of water, obviously just outside of Mosul. And it had not been maintained for a number of decades, obviously, because what happened in Iraq, it was slowly eroding, and what, from what my limited understanding of it, my GCSE science, that is basically the dam was getting deeper because of the internal erosion, because it was built on like chalk or something like that. Like Saddam Hussein decided that this big showpiece of architecture would show his authority across the country, but actually it was very poorly designed because it just, you know, eroded itself deeper and deeper and deeper, and the glacial water that run off the mountains would just keep on filling it up. So essentially you can imagine it's going like that. The pressure on the wall, on the actual dam itself, was getting greater and greater and greater. There's like sort of two or three runoff like outlets for the excess water to go off to stop it from going over the top. And they were slowly failing like one after another because no one was able to maintain them. So the pressure on this wall was increasing, and it was I think early 2016 when the US government started to really recognize that there was an actual substantial problem here, and all the modeling and the forecasting they could see was that if the Mosul dam blew, it would have been the single biggest humanitarian disaster that the world had ever seen at that point, because it follows the line of the Euphrates, I'm gonna guess, and it would have, they're predicting that it would go all the way down to Baghdad. It'd wash away Mosul, wash away a lot of cities en route to Baghdad, and because no one had ever seen or predicted a humanitarian disaster this big, no one could say if Baghdad would be completely underwater or if there'd be a slight trickle. You know, the forecasting was so wildly varied that no one could say what was actually happening. And I was the advisor for our officers in Baghdad at the time, and so we were obviously working through contingency plans, but trying to get the organization to understand just how big this issue could have been was, you know, at times it felt like banging your head against a brick wall, you know. And for somebody so junior, and I'd only been in the organization for like 3 or 4 months, so I was still cutting my teeth, you know, to then, and I had to go and see specialist people in the FCO who were taking it very, very seriously. And, you know, there's people banding around these like, yeah, it's days away, if not, you know, not weeks away anymore. And then trying to relay this with a sense of urgency to the organization and say, I think we need to be investing in contingency planning and with the equipment for this, and we need to take this really seriously. You know, you'd have to put this out in a meeting and see where it'd go from there. But again, you used to get an instant feedback and people are going, holy fuck, we should take this seriously or not. And you look around at a sea of blank faces, and you're not too sure if you feel like an idiot or if you feel like you're doing something right for the organization.
And you used to take, people looking at things objectively.
Yeah.
And listening to the facts that are being said and then making a judgment on that.
Yeah.
With very little attention paid to the political side of things, as in internal politics, as to whether they think that you saying this and then people agreeing with you is going to better your career, and that's not good for their career. Yeah. All that stupid crap.
Yeah,
which
yeah.
you get everywhere. Which you get everywhere. But you get it less in the military. You just get it less.
Yeah,
there.
You do.
So
yeah,
you step
yeah.
like, again, you just like, civvies.
You know how intelligence can be measured in different areas. You know how it's like intelligence now means like, you know, different things. You get like social intelligence, like yep. spatial intelligence, things like that. I'm not quite sure what the word is for it, but there must be, or must be a form of like social intelligence, you know, about being able to, I guess maybe it's empathy, I don't know. But it's something which you, maybe it's a skill which you kind of lose in the military a bit, because you're used to, you know, saying you give as much, give everyone a chance to voice their opinion to a point, don't you? But at some stage you've got to say, right, we're just fucking doing it, you know, we're going left flanking or we're going right flanking or whatever. Mm-hmm. In the civilian sector, because it's not like it's life or death, there's so much more conversation that could be had. And I think managing your frustration but learning to, you know, understand other people and get inside their heads is one of those skills which you definitely start to become more aware of when you leave the military, I would suggest. Certainly for me, you know, it's an underused skill, or lesser used skill in the military, but so critical to succeeding outside of the military. You know, it's something, you know, I wish they could teach on the career transition partnership, if it wasn't such a, you know, this nebulous fluffy term, you know, that's like kind of hard to, yeah. you know, hard to describe, you know. So it's almost like just, you know, just network with people and build social capital with them, because that's how you're gonna get anything done as a civilian. You know,
absolutely. Outside. Did the dam burst?
No, it didn't. No, thankfully.
It's still there now.
Yeah, yeah. I think at the time, an Italian. So what happened? Like, there's an Italian company that got like U.S. Military security, and they were able to go in and get like the let off valves, I think, repaired, and you know, they had enough security, they weren't threatened by ISIS, and they could actually repair the dam to a, you know, much better stage. But it was like pretty critical at one point, you know. People saying that it's gonna be a few days before it bursts, and even the BBC itself was reporting on it at the same time as trying to figure out how we actually dealt with it as an organization.
Crazy.
And so yeah, it's pretty nuts.
How do we get into that? BBC High Risk. Okay,
yeah, then you BBC moved, High yeah. Risk. Yeah. And then, yeah, so 5 months of that, I mean, it's great fun, you know, I was surrounded by a military team, but 5 months of being in New Broadcasting House, being in Oxford Circus in winter, you know, it's a pretty bleak place. Having to commute every day it sounds ridiculous, but spending an hour on the tube and an hour back again, when you're used to, you know, rolling out of your bed, going and getting showered, and then, rolling down to the galley for breakfast, then like, you know, 5 minute walk away to the office.
Yeah.
You know, to when you start throwing commuting in there, and you know, an hour sounds like nothing out of your day, does it? You know, but when you spend it on tubes every single day, 5 days a week, it was just that plus a whole compound of, you know, things that led me to just resign from the BBC and go freelance.
So how did that work then? What did you do? Going freelance doing what? Security?
Security advising, yeah. So I'd love to say there was a real business plan and a vision behind it. It was more probably born out of frustration and realizing that I wasn't getting the travel that I wanted. I wasn't having the same kind of purpose that I thought I would have outside the military. And the way that I saw to change this was to go as a consultant, so I could do the fun things that I wanted to do, like, you know, running and mountain biking, all the fizz things that I love, but then combine it with some international travel and, you know, working overseas with like more humanitarian organizations. So it was slightly born out of frustration, but there was a kind of a loose plan to it as well. But that's what got me out to Afghanistan the first time. So an opportunity came up from an RMP mate to go and do some hostile environment training for the...
Your RMP as well?
Ex-RMP, yeah.
Right.
Just go, right. Keep that.
Switch
in back
the microphones off. Yeah. Who's recording who? Who's recording who?
Definitely go on. Got a wire on.
Yeah, go on.
So next RMP, mate. I'm gonna get neat shit for this for tomorrow as well. I just know.
What for? What
on the Pegasus? lunch. I'm gonna have to get out as a caveat.
Pegasus Network at lunch are good, mate.
That'll be absolutely
afterwards. You might get a slag in. Anyway, because you were late. Afghan.
So I ended up with Afghan. Yeah, so I had an opportunity to go and work with the biggest charity out in Afghanistan, which is the Aga Khan Foundation, doing hostile environment training for them for 6 weeks. So I got my wish to go and see Afghanistan. I spent 6 weeks in Kabul teaching this charity and immersing myself in, like, you know, the NGO lifestyle and kind of how they live out there and do the things they do without the big, you know, security bubble as such.
Risky, right?
It is really, when you come from obviously the military and you've got, you know, the military prides itself on shaping things so that you give yourself the best possible chance, and then you go to work with a charity sector who have got a very different mindset in, you know, security. I wouldn't say security is an afterthought, because that's not for a lot of the big ones, but it's it comes very much secondary to kind of their operations, you know. So they do it on a much more like, acceptance is much more of a bigger thing there rather than hard physical security like armored vehicles and body armor and stuff. But yeah, so it got me out to Kabul for 6 weeks, which was is really illuminating, you know, because obviously lost a lot of mates out in Afghanistan, and for the first time I was able to see it with my own eyes and experience it. It was a great experience, but it's only several months after that when I started hearing about what these athletes were doing there that I really felt I had to go back there as a civilian and see it again, you know, and investigate these stories that I was hearing on social media.
How did you hear about it then? how are you on social media, right? Sorry.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Okay. Right.
So the Olympic Channel featured a story about some mountain bikers in Kabul. They'd got these like rudimentary mountain bikes and were doing dirt jumping just outside of Kabul, and for the things I'd heard from the military, the time I'd spent in Kabul, it just seemed like mind-boggling. You know, how were these kids managing to get these bikes out there, and they're pretty good bikes as well. How were they managing to maintain them, and how were they, like, how come there wasn't people covering this, you know, this story? Because it was. The one group in particular which I've been working with, called Drop and Ride, they pride themselves on having boys and girls openly ride bikes together,
which in
Kabul, which, as you can imagine, invites a huge amount of criticism, yep, harassment, you know, potential targeting by Taliban and IS, and for them to do it so.
How old are they, mate? How old are they?
Like early 20s. So they interviewed the two leaders, a guy called Asgar and a girl called Zara, who were 19, I think, both at the same time. And these, you know, these kids were able somehow to get these mountain bikes in country, and they had ramps, and they had organization, and they would, it was just, yeah, like the look on your face pretty much was the look on my face. I remember like seeing it on my phone, and instantly I was like, fucking hell, I've got to hear more about this. And that led me to message a load of people that I met from the charities in Kabul to find out if I could get a connection. Within an hour, I had their Facebook profiles, you know, sent from these NGO friends. And so just added them on Facebook, just started messaging them and was like, you know, what you're doing is really cool. I'd love to come out and meet you guys. And that was just where the conversations went from there.
That led to the second time then, did it?
So that led to the next time, yeah.
What was your plan? Like, do a story on it, do a book or what? or anything, or just see it?
It led me to start doing more research to see what other sports were out there, because it was so surprising, you know, because given what I'd seen in Kabul, you know, it was just utterly, I just could not fathom, you know, how these kids were getting these things out there in the first place, so... I did a search for other sports out there, found some parkour free runners, I found some skiers in Bamyan, I found runners, mountaineers, and, you know, it's almost like I was just picking away at the surface, and all of a sudden all these other sports were just revealing themselves. And you know, you could do like a the odd search here and there, and you might see like a very tiny snippet about the skiers or something about the runners or something about the mountain bikers. I had like a little bit of exposure. So I started messaging out mates from media and like ex-military mates, and ended up with a guy coming forward who was a reservist from my last job in the RMR, coming forward and saying, I'm a videographer. Quite happily come out to you. I'd never been out to Afghanistan. I'd love to come out with you and, you know, let's see if we can video these guys and see if we can make a documentary out of this. So yeah, the idea, you know, started to form itself. We went out there with the idea of producing a documentary and, you know, literally bimbling around Kabul to meet these, you know, these athletes. And I'd love to say there was a like a grand plan for it, but it just started to evolve organically. You know, it was, we could see these guys doing these really cool things, and we're like, you know, the world needs to know about this because Afghanistan's only known about, only spoken about in like conflict, and, you know, strife, and, you know, everyone, you know, certainly in you know, that I know back here only knows it through the stories that, you know, my friends, my brother, family, like you and other people have told. And so I wanted to start showing another side to Afghanistan, you know, this unfolding narrative of sports in Afghanistan, for example.
Well, with the bike, the mountain bikers,
yeah,
the encouraging the, you know, male and female to do that together. What's the motivation there? Given that the repercussions can be flipping lethal, it's on them, on their families, you know, from people like Taliban, IS, or just flipping hardcore religious people.
Yeah.
What's the motivation with it? I mean. Did they try and keep it a secret? How do they go about it?
Not really. It's I think that the motivation is they just love riding bikes. You know, they're essentially kids. You know, they're 19 years old. They're a bit older than that now, but they just had this love of mountain biking. And actually, their name Drop and Ride came from watching Danny McCaskill videos on YouTube. So you know, that they'd all had access to smartphones. There was like a burgeoning 3G network growing out there, so they're able to get access to the internet. They'd obviously at some point procured some bikes, started googling and watching YouTube videos of Danny McCaskill. And then they were like, oh cool, yeah. So they started doing the tricks, you know, obviously they're seen on YouTube, and then they wanted to form some kind of organization. So they you know, did it in homage to Danny McCaskill, and they started inviting other kids to come and join the mountain biking because they had access to a safe space. So they're set up by two Hazara, you know, the Asghar and Zara Hazaras. So they're in sort of like a quite distinct part of Kabul. And they just started inviting all these other kids who they knew to come and ride with them. You know,
explain Hazara. Sorry.
So it's one of the kind of five or six ethnicities in Afghanistan. You'll have to forgive me, put me on the spot, but you've got Pashtuns, Tajiks, Uzbeks, Hazaras, another major one which I think I'm forgetting. I'm doing a disservice here, but the Hazara community is about 15% of the overall of Afghanistan.
Significant then.
Sorry, 15.
Quite significant, 15. Yeah.
So, I mean, they're one of the smallest, I think fourth or fifth like kind of ranking, but Pashtuns make up the majority. So they had this, they managed to get this training space in West Kabul, and they just started inviting other kids to come and ride with them. And so they had Pashtuns, Tajiks, Uzbeks coming to join them for this mountain biking because they were managing to get other, you know, other mountain bikes from, you know, no idea where. And obviously they formed this team that, you know, the Drop and Ride team, and just started self-teaching themselves freestyle mountain bike tricks. Then obviously the older, more capable, stronger members then teach it to the younger members, and, you know, so on and so forth. But what was so incredible about it is obviously they're learning things like English through these YouTube videos. So what they're doing is they're then able to create relationships with people outside of their own communities. They're pulling in multi ethnicities into this training ground through the vehicle of freestyle mountain biking, but then they're gaining education for it as well. So they're not, you know, they're as well as going to school, but they're also learning, you know, their English is coming on leaps and bounds because they're watching these YouTube videos. So they want to get better at mountain biking. So it's like a second order effect of you know, their passion for these bikes is that they're learning English. And then, you know, when it comes to me messaging Asgard, the leader of the team, through Facebook Messenger, we can have a proper conversation on Facebook. And, you know, he can tell me, you know, we've got these bikes, but we need these parts. And, you know, and all of a sudden it's like, you know, we have this conversation about doing 360s on his bikes and, you know, like, you know, what kind of disc brakes he likes the best. And, you know, it was probably one of the more random, you know, a situation was growing where I was like, this is not only incredibly inspiring, but something that the world needs to see, because, you know, particularly from the military community, it's Afghanistan was a huge challenge for us, you know, mm-hmm. you know, militarily. We all lost a lot of mates there, and you know, there's a lot of time and effort and energy invested into the country, and now and there's very very few good news stories coming out of Afghanistan, and this was the one which I think that particularly millennials in our, you know, in the West need to know about, is that you know, there's kids doing exactly the same sports out in Afghanistan as they're doing here in the, you know, here in the West.
Mm. Oh yeah, true. What sport had the biggest sort of following? The biggest number of participants that you saw? You said you had running. I'm guessing running. You had running.
Yeah, you had running. I mean, it's the ones with the low barriers to entry. So, running. But the running is run for a specific charity called Free to Run, which is set up by an ultra runner called Steph. That had a moderately big draw to it, but it was predominantly female, so female empowerment through running.
Okay.
But they allowed like some younger men to join as well. But in actual fact, it was probably the parkour team. So the I don't know if you see, have you ever seen like free running, the guys that run and jump off, obviously, like concrete bollards, and it's basically like street gymnastics, isn't it?
Yeah.
Again, that's got such a low barrier to entry. You know, you essentially just need a pair of sweatpants and a pair of trainers, don't you? And you can go and do backflips off anything. Mm-hmm. And so this is like a majority male team. You had these young men that were getting together and learning backflips and, you know, handstands. You know, all these weird and wonderful tricks I don't know the name of. They were doing them, you know, out in the street. you know, again, like you had these like adult. It was set up by a guy called Jamil who, again, would watch YouTube videos on how to do things, and he would influence the kids around him. And, you know, it's almost like this trickle down effect of, you know, I've seen like kids that are like, I don't know, 8 or 9, maybe 10 years old, out there doing backflips downstairs. And, you know, part of me saying, fucking hell, this is, if this goes wrong, that's a 10-year-old that, you know, might be severely injured for the rest of his life. But there's another flip side, you're thinking, this is incredible. This kid's like got this incredible gymnastic skill. He's doing it without any encouragement from anyone else because he looks up to these slightly older, you know, guys who are teaching these skills. And it's, mm-hmm. you know, it's, I guess it's leadership in its rawest form, isn't it? You know, there's, you can't kind of make this thing happen. It's just grown out of this desire to better themselves at, you know, a sporting endeavor.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, parkour probably one of the biggest one. Although the mountain bikers are growing in size a lot more because they're probably a bit easier to market in places, you know, because they've got a very clear narrative, you know. They say like boys and girls should, you know, can ride bikes together. Security wise, if there's a security incident, they can, you know, they can nip in and out of like parts of Kabul very quickly, you know. So they can get away riding their bikes in, you know, say in a park in Kabul. If they start getting harassed, they can just ride away and be away in a few minutes, you know. So it makes them a bit harder to target, but
yeah,
I think also, yeah, they've got a slightly better social media presence as well.
Mm-hmm. How long were you out there that time then, that second time?
That was 2 weeks. So I went there February 2017. Sandro, who's a videographer mate, and I spent 2 weeks essentially driving around Kabul, filming the different sports, you know. And it was, he would obviously concentrate on the filming, and I would concentrate on you know, putting everything together. So I guess producing, for want of a better word, yep. You know, speaking with the contributors and organizing all the different teams to meet us at various parts of Kabul. We had this awesome time just driving around the city, just hanging out with these different athletes. and it was, you know, it's largely secured. Like, you know, one day we had Taliban did a complex attack on a military base on the route that we were supposed to be going down, and so we had to just kind of abort, turn around and go back to the guest house for a day. But, you know, apart from that, it was largely safe. And yeah, we, you know, we got to hang out with all these different athletes, and it was that time for me was it was hugely inspiring, because it was you know, it's my first self-funded trip out there, and I started to realize that this was something that I could have a real effect on. You know, no one else was concentrating on all these different sports that were happening, and that I was, you know, was in a quite a privileged position to be able to start getting their stories out there. So I started speaking to mates in the BBC and anyone that would listen, you know, about these athletes that were doing cool things. And
where did the first Afghan on Everest thing come about then? Can you talk about that or not?
Yeah. So,
because I think it was Paul said to me that the way you put it is you're trying to connect. You explain it to me.
Yeah. It doesn't always make sense to me, so you may get several different answers out of me. I'm still piecing it together as to why it's a good thing, but I think I'm getting closer and closer. So the reason why the Hiatus Foundation needs to exist is because there's a gap for support for these different sports. So women runners, for example, are getting supported by one charity. Women mountaineers are getting supported by another charity. Trying to think if there's a couple of other charities doing things on individual sports, but no one's doing projects with all the different athletes, you know. So there's everyone's working very siloed, I guess, to give it like business talk. So I wanted to start to pull the sector together a little bit more and start finding economies of effort, you know, ways that, but because what we're starting to see was that the different sports teams were becoming aware of each other and then seeking out each other for advice and support and trading ideas, you know, and starting to work together. So there's this really cool effect of where you're actually creating this sort of cohesive group of athletes and influencers, positive influencers, you know, which you'd hope in the future would translate into much better relationships for those individuals. But that was a byproduct. Where the Everest thing came from was wanting to change the narrative of Afghanistan, because there's so many bad news stories about it. You know, it's always a case of this suicide attack's happened, or this town's been lost to the Taliban, or this happened. There's very little out there. There's very little good news stories out there which change the narrative to you know, the other generation. You know, we know a lot about Helmand. We know a lot about Kabul for those that served there, but there's a whole, you know, the rest of the country suffers from the bad parts which we in the West know about.
Yeah.
Of the 34 provinces in Afghanistan, depending on what out agency you look at, there's anywhere between 45% and 55% of it are affected by the Taliban. So there's a whole like 18 provinces that don't have Taliban affected by them. Mm-hmm. One of them's the mountains, the central mountainous region, which is where the Hazaras live. So you've got you know, that's where skiing's popped up, for example, and like this whole kind of winter mountain sports community's popped up. And so I guess in my quest to start understanding how I could change the narrative of Afghanistan, and you know, whether that helps tourism or not, or helps like investment in the future, is that I decided that I'd do something to help you know, an Afghan, you know, create this good news story, which became, you know, Afghan and Everest. I've got this personal life goal when I left the military that I wanted to do the seven summits, but do this in a slightly different way. That's
all the continents, right?
Yes, yeah. The highest mountain on the seven continents. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Everest being the one for Asia. And so this personal life goal, which I'd set for myself, started to become entwined with this charity idea that I wanted to get support for these Afghan athletes. So on the last trip I went out, the last trip was 2 weeks ago, I was very hugely privileged enough to spend a day on the mountains around Kabul with some guys who are actual mountaineers, you know, for want of a better word.
Afghan mountaineers.
Yeah. So we spent a day climbing up to 2,500 meters, and hung out and had this had fried eggs and tuna in this kind of like bivvy spot overlooking Kabul. Is the most bizarre but awesome experience I've had in the mountains.
What kit are they using? Have they got decent kit? Are they, you know, when you look at them, you think mountaineer, am I looking at, you know, NIMS or someone?
No. Literally, imagine, like, if you walked out onto the street around here, pulled the nearest bloke into the studio, and then six of his mates, that's what the mountaineers were wearing in Kabul. So you had everyone from, you had one of the guys who had a pair of donated US Marine Corps boots, some like cotton cargo, you know, trousers, which, you know, just completely just suck up the water as soon as you step into the snow. You know, he's got a day sack and a bit of a sort of down like jacket. Everyone else was like jeans, you know, pretty much Chelsea boots, leather jacket, you know, a woolly jumper if he's got it, and then you know, like a grocery bag of like fruit, or, you know, one of them had a backpack and just pulled out this tray of eggs.
Proper Afghan.
It was, yeah.
And then you're climbing mountains.
And we were traipsing through the snow for over 4 hours, you know, and I'm not talking a light dusting of snow, as in it was knee to hip deep snow for 4 hours. You know, we're trudging up this hill, and I didn't have insulated boots. No one had insulated boots on. I had trekking boots. You know, within like half an hour, you know, feet were absolutely sodden, soaking wet. You know, you start to get a little bit cold, and then you turn around and there's a bloke in, you know, leather Chelsea boots, jeans, and, you know, a leather jacket.
Was anyone in flip flops? No one. That's disappointing. You left me down in Afghanis. Yeah.
But yeah, so, you know, their passion, their enthusiasm, and their resilience is just
amazing, isn't
second
it?
Second to none. And it was. They wanted to. We'd met a couple of days before that to talk about Everest, and they wanted to. You know, they wanted to show me this part of Kabul which not many other people get to see. I'll be honest, I was pretty nervous arranging it over Facebook, and I was like, you know, the guy I was staying with in the guest house is a hoofing bloke. He's an ex-Royal Engineer who runs a guest house in Kabul, and it's the only place I'd ever stay. You know, I told him what my plan, and he was like, mate, you know, you've got trackers, you got your mobile phones, you know, if anything goes wrong, just give us a buzz and we'll figure it out. You know, and by the way, none of them spoke English.
Wait, is that how you did English. The plans for the BBC?
I know a lot of people will be listening to this thinking, who is this cavalier idiot and why the fuck did they give him a commission in the Marines? You know, I'd like to just like to, for the record, just say that I'm much better at planning things. I take it very seriously, planning things, but I felt like the risk was worth it. The juice was worth the squeeze.
Yeah, well, bless. Probably would never bloody happen otherwise, would it? Goodness me.
But yeah, so we trudged up this mountain to 2,500 meters. One of them brought a snowboard. You know, there's like one snowboard between like eight people. the snow was frozen, so it was there's like a 2 or 3 inch frozen skin on top of it. So you went to stand on it, it'd hold your weight for a millisecond, then obviously you sink. So your hip flexors are just constantly getting thrashed. You know, God. It's like you can't. It's not just like walking through snow. It's like, but yeah, it's you know.
Did they go boarding? Did they?
No, because the snow was frozen. Fair, yeah. Just it wouldn't support the. It was that weird kind of snow where you can sit on top of it at like 60 or 70 degree slope and not move anywhere. It was crazy. Utterly bizarre. Yeah, not something I've ever seen before.
So that was your 2 week trip.
That was 10 days.
That was 10 days.
Yeah.
And then what? How are you planning on? Which one of the lucky mountaineers is going to go up Everest? How's that? How far along the plan is that?
It's still very very early stage. I've always said that I want to try and get the first male and the first female mountaineer on top of Everest, which is quite a ballsy call. It's something that I'm constantly reassessing because the cultural dynamics of obviously getting women involved in mountaineering as well with men is still very still very challenging. So I don't want it to be one of those projects which takes a decade to happen. I want the athletes to be benefiting from the good news stories now, to start changing the narrative. So I may have to relook at it, but at the moment, planning on 3 men and 3 women attempting it in 2021.
Awesome.
Again, subject to funding, subject to clearance. We've got to do a test. We want to do a test climb within Afghanistan. There's a 7,500-meter mountain there called the Noshak.
Is it really? I didn't know that.
Yeah. It's kind of little known about. So it's in near the Wakhan corridor. Obviously, the part that obviously Levwood and a lot of guys have or people have like trekked through, and that's quite a secure area in that you can go in through Tajikistan and not have to go through Kabul. So it's probably the more benign area of Afghanistan, but it's just on the border there. And it'd make a great test peak for seeing who could deal with the elevation for Everest.
How technical is it, do you know?
It's actually more technical than Everest from what I understand. I know a few people who've done it, and actually I'm talking to them to figure out the logistics of actually making it happen in the first place, because it's still very remote. It's only last October, November that the first woman and the first Afghan woman summited the Noshak. So it's it's still an expedition in itself just to make that happen, and an expensive one at that.
What's Roy at now then?
With the charity or with the Everest expedition?
With flipping life charity hiatus.
I'm still within the registration process. So turning it into like an actual charity means having trustees, a mission statement, proving that actually fulfills a need as well. So for a charity to exist, you've got 13 lines of operation that you need to be able to prove that you support. The veterans is one, for example. Like children's education is another.
13,
yeah. So you've got to prove you do something in those 13 streams that it makes it a charitable organization. So trying to be a consultant and also get this charity off the ground is like the hardest thing at the moment.
So you're still doing your risk management advising on the side as well, yeah?
Yes. So I'm a security advisor for media and humanitarian sector. And that essentially like pays, means that I can live and eat and sleep, and the rest of the money, just gets ploughed into trying to get this Hiatus Foundation idea off the ground. All the last two times I've been to Afghanistan have both been self-funded trips.
Hard work, mate.
People have that same look when you say tell people that I'm going out to Afghanistan for a holiday, and they're like, oh yeah, whatever, idiot. I'm actually going out to Afghanistan to go snowboarding, climb some mountains.
What's the hardest with that, with the foundation charity? you got to explain the 13 streams. What's the hardest part about it? Trying to getting registered like that. How many hoops did it jump through? How rigid are they with the charity and the charity commission?
Pretty rigid from what I know, because a lot of changes have happened over the last few years. There's been the fundraising scandal, for example, the child safeguarding scandal. It's becoming increasingly more difficult to set up a charity, and I guess rightfully so as well, because there's a load of spurious charities out there. There's some which probably shouldn't be in existence. There's some which aren't as efficient as they should be. But then, wanting to make sure that there's a lot of charities out there, and I essentially wanted to make sure that what I was doing was fulfilling a genuine need, as opposed to just having this philanthropic adventure, I was kind of passing off as a charity. And
that's good. I like that. And the reason being is that I like that the reason behind the Hiatus Foundation, for plugging the gap, there's an actual gap there. There's like something like 4,000 registered military charities in the UK.
Yeah. military charities alone, not just charity.
Military in the UK. It's mental.
Wow.
It is mental, right? I can't remember where I got the number from, but it's right. And a lot of that's to do with, and again, there's loads of charities that do the same things other charities doing, large and small. And a lot of it's to do with when something's, it's poorly managed. The charities are just poorly managed. As in, that charity sector's poorly managed. And that's resulted in, like you said, you get flipping lunatic charities who either just have no clue what they're doing, or they're doing things for the wrong reasons, skimming money, or whatever, you know, the score, the scams. But it's like a byproduct of being mismanaged. This charity commission being mismanaged, but then how did you deal with it? A question I have, when this subject comes up, a sort of question goes through my head is, should we have a charity dedicated to a sector? Like, okay, we're going to talk about cancer research.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There's going to be one charity for that. Cancer Research UK, for example. You're going to be that charity. Any other charities that have registered as to do with cancer research or cancer, you are all going to be amalgamated and you're part of Cancer Research UK now.
Yeah.
So they're all in the one body. I'm not saying it's a solution. I'm literally talking out loud, thinking out loud, right? But then it's easy to regulate them because you'll have less charities. You're regulating the sector as opposed to a gazillion different charities.
And they get economies. Sorry to interrupt. They get economies of effort as well, in that you don't have, an organisation can be much more efficient by having one that manages it. That brings in. It means they're not all fighting for donations. They're not all fighting to get marketing messages out there. They're not all having to hire, HR teams and finance teams, and the costly stuff just to make a charity happen. Is where if you amalgamate them, then you can get a lot more economies of effort.
Yeah, you could. They could still function as there's when you brought them all into one big charity. You brought the others in. They can still function as a charity, but their sector would be narrowed. Yeah. So think, going back to the military side of things, you could have a charity deals with mental health. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you got the overarching whatever, and you have a charity, and their job is mental health.
Yeah.
And that's what they do. They go out, they do their campaigning, they do their fundraising. All that's for, this is for raising money for veterans. Mental health, and we are part of the veterans charity, whatever. Yeah, you'd have a perfect example of a gap filling charity is Care After Combat.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard of Care After Combat?
I can't say.
No. They're growing. Care After Combat. I've had a couple of guys in the show. Care After Combat, founded by Jim Davidson, active manager, is that right? Active CEO, chairman, whatever of it. He's really active in it. But what they deal with is veterans who are convicts, veterans in prison. Okay.
Yeah.
So they go help them out and help them in prison, help rehabilitate them, get them out, and then get them back on their feet in civil street and help them. And since they formed, I'm going to butcher these figures, but since they formed and started doing what they do, as in helping people in prison out, veterans, the reoffending rate has dropped by something like 20 or 30%.
Oh wow.
It's huge. They've only gone a couple of years, to the point where they're now got the government and going, look what we've done here. This is, I'm not saying, look at us, but maybe you should consider something for normal convicts, and you're just on this model. Just go in, help out in the manner we're doing, and you reduce the reoffending rate, better for society, cheaper for the government, prisons got not as overpopulated, but I'm fucking waffling.
It sounds a bit like the Three Pillars Project. I'm not sure if you know Mike Crofts. He's an ex-tanks officer. I get introduced to him by Bags, obviously. The Bags.
The Bags, yeah.
He's doing a great job of doing what you just said there, like rehabilitating prisoners through sport. So if he uses rugby as the vehicle, and he gives them a training syllabus, and they come out with a qualification at the end, and then they have a footstep into a civilian career as a rugby coach, because he's obviously got a business that works alongside of it as well. So it's almost like a whole pathway, gives them the training in prison. When they get out, they've got that organization they can go straight into, and then they start to manager and transition back into a civil society. And they've, I don't know, again, it would be remiss of me to try and guess the figures, but it's a, you know, the, it looks like it works from all the videos.
I have spoken to Mike Croft. Yeah, I'm sure I heard about that, and someone put him on to me to talk to him for the podcast. But
yeah,
I've not heard of three pillars. There's yeah. There's, I mean, there's some awesome charities out there do really good work. You know,
yeah, yeah.
Flipping, but. Again, it's one of those things. It's almost pointless to even discussing it because there's no way back. What it's like a devolution. What you're going to do? Bin all these charities in the head. It's just so flipping complicated now. What'd you do?
Yeah, and I must admit, actually, that was, and I must have kicked around the idea of a charity for at least 6 months. It all started off in early last year when the mountain bikers they had GoPros and they broke their last working GoPro, and they asked me if I had any spare ones, and I kind of looked over my shelf and realized I had a GoPro 1 and 2 just sat there gathering dust, and you know, sent it out to them, and it was, you know, there was a need, and we kind of like, you know, plugged this gap, if you were. So, you know, at the time it was like, oh, it's simple, just send them out the GoPros. But then I put a call out on social media and said, has anyone else got any more GoPros? Because it'd be really cool to send these out to these Afghan sports teams. And again, just, you know, Facebook messengers went nuts with people saying, oh, I've got no GoPro. I mean, can't be asked to put it on eBay. If you're in London next week, I'll give it to you then. We'll grab a coffee or, you know, just send it to you. And it was almost like I was taking a job off other people because they couldn't be asked to put it on eBay or sell it. We know what to do with it. And I was like, well, I've got, you know, mates who travel out to Afghan, you know, frequently. I just give it to them and they pass it on to the athletes. And, you know, again, it was like, this is really a really good feeling. And there's, you know, a need and a solution here to kind of two problems. But it's not like you can make a charity out of just recycling GoPros, you know, or you shouldn't make a charity out of recycling GoPros. But what it did help me to understand actually was that the way that social media can help these athletes is by increasing their profile and then getting them future gear donations. They've got the resources to do these sports, and actually their barriers to entry are brought down. The kind of Hiatus Foundation was literally there for fixing short-term specific focused needs rather than just being a charity for charity's sake, because I think that's, you know, the worst thing a charity can do is just exist to continue its own existence.
And the aim of the Hiatus Foundation, right, is, I'm asking, so just to want to clarify it, right, is to enable these sports in Afghanistan specifically?
It started off as conflict zones in general, but then focusing on Afghanistan
is a start point, right? Yeah. So conflict zones in general, raise awareness for those countries that isn't as there are positives. I was going to say it isn't as bad as it seems. It fucking is bad there, but there are positives there, and you can help. The Hiatus Foundation is there to help these positives grow.
Yes, yeah, yeah. Right. So it's there to. Obviously, sports is a provides like psychosocial support in times of need, doesn't it? I mean, you know, when I grew up in Somerset, you know, mountain biking was my kind of my go to sport for, you know, just dealing with like the rigors and challenges of growing up, you know. In Somerset, I know there's rigors in Somerset as well. Yeah, yeah, I know. When the cider runs out, it's you know, there's like just all kinds of fighting between the yokels. So the Hiatus Foundation, I guess, exists to continue that form of psychosocial support, because it's, you know, these kids, when you see them riding, they are having a fucking great time. You know, it's like all of a sudden they forget they're in a conflict zone, and it's more about goofing around on bikes or rollerblades or, you know, any one of the other kind of sports that you see out there. And you know, that's improving their quality of life for one thing. It's making them a little bit happier. I think it's probably, I'd say it's distracting them from the draw of fundamentalism. You know, if you're busy playing with bikes and, you know, skateboards and things, then you're not really interested in, you know, in fundamentalism. You know, if you can make that such a boring, irrelevant concept, like, will it die away of its own accord? You know, that's a whole other kind of subject of discussion. But there's so many benefits to the sports out there that just giving them the actual act of giving a GoPro out to one of these athletes is, it's not really about the GoPro. It's more the fact that somebody on the other side of the world gives a shit enough to put a little bit of effort in and send out it's not only a GoPro, it's a message. You know, it's like mountain bikers in this country are thinking about mountain bikers in this country, and this is where I think you get that pan global support network of sports. It's where, you know, it's where politics can't ever do that. You know, politics, you know, tribes, you know, they're very geographically bound, aren't they? Sports has the ability to transcend languages, to transcend countries, to transcend politics, to transcend tribes. And this is why I believe so much in that sports is a great thing for Afghanistan. But right now, traditional aid and charities aren't focusing on it. You know, it's all about the, you know, in parts the humanitarian need, but then also, you know, people are trying to fix governance institutions, or, you know, trying to bring about peace, when in actual fact, you know, these kids, you know, and they are fucking kids, you know, these are the ones that are the future of the country, and they're the ones that are, you know, getting kind of looked past. You know, it seems like a no-brainer that you'd you know, you just invest in these kids, and as soon as the last of the Taliban start to die off, you know, you're left with a generation of people that you know, are educated through these sports, they're engaged, they've got healthy relationships with their peers, they've got a healthy approach to life. You know, it's for me, you know, watching it grow on a day-by-day basis is probably one of the most inspiring things of, you know, my day. It's of all the, you know, of all the negative time, all the negative press that Afghanistan gets, and, you know, the negative stories that we hear, and the badness we hear about the country, there's 10 stories going on in Kabul and Bamiyan and Mazar-i-Sharif, you know, of good things that are happening. It's just they haven't got the attention of the world yet. I just rambled massively then.
No, it makes perfect sense. It's not something I thought about before. Makes perfect sense. And it's interesting what you say about giving a stimulating alternative to the norm, and drawing them away from the fundamentalism, you know, and almost perceiving it as, oh God, I need to go and do that.
Yeah.
If I'm doing that, I can't go for a run. I can't go meet the other ladies and
yeah, yeah.
and go and do something that I'm not allowed to do normally.
Yeah, yeah, you know, exactly. Yeah.
Mountain biking or go mountaineering in my flipping my jeans. Madness, isn't it? Madness. What are you all set up for the Pegasus networking lunch tomorrow? The talk.
Mostly, yeah. I'm walking in there with the expectation of getting neat shit as soon as I open my mouth and say, I'm an ex RMP and bootneck. I never deployed to Afghanistan, but I'm going to talk to you, room full of badass warriors, about what's good about Afghanistan.
Mate, no, yeah, sure. You get a mixer, and you get business people like me. You'll be on the ball. Be really well received. You're missing good people there. I don't think I can get there tomorrow. Possibly. If I can, I will. Yeah, we got about 4 minutes left. Short one, as I said, because the officer, yeah, BBC high risk Marine RMP was late.
Apologies. I try and blame it on London, but you know, my bad admin.
Yeah, a few minutes left. Anything we haven't covered you want to go on to? Anything, so where do you want to direct people to? How do people find you? Shameless plug.
Okay, hiatusfoundation.com. Again, and saw that on social media. Massive shout out to Team Rubicon UK. If there's people here listening to the podcast who are in transition, I would massively steer them towards Team Rubicon. I think it's like one of the best transition tips, you know, that you can have. It gives you an instant network when you get out of the military. It gives you a support function in that you can talk to like-minded people. Worst case scenario, you can crash there overnight if, you know, if all else goes Pete Tong.
You made a really good point, mate. That I had James Glancy on yesterday.
Yes, yeah, I saw
you. Made a really good point that we came on and there as well, just by chance. And you said, when you were talking at the start, you were saying about transitioning out of the military and civil street, and one of the things you identified is that lack of objective, mission, meaningful work, you know, you're talking about. And I felt the same thing. James did the same. And I think that, I mean, when you were talking about it earlier, I think we're lucky. Oh, it took me flipping years to realize it, but we're lucky in that we realized it at a point. Guaranteed, right? Guaranteed there are people listening to this. I fucking guarantee it. Mm-hmm. 'Cause I know I got some friends who listen to this. It was exactly the position like I was in. You know, think not exactly the same position, but sort of mindset. I think in, they're just saying at me. Oh, they're just not happy. They don't know what it is.
Yeah.
They think, oh, I've got a shit job. Or I don't like my life. They don't even know what it is. It's what the fuck? Something's missing. And they got, and when they get a good feeling when they meet up back up with the blokes or the ladies, if they're a lady serving, they get meet up with the units, make a phone call, have a piss up often, and they get a good feeling then.
Yeah.
And then they don't get it any other time. So they're like, I miss the military. I should never got out, or this, that, the other. As you said earlier, and you said, and Team Rubicon is a really good example. It's not the only example, it's a really good example, though.
Yeah.
And as I said with Jim yesterday when we were talking, it's that find something that is a good thing to do, a good thing that doesn't cost you money.
Yeah. Yeah.
It might cost you a bit of time, right? And a perfect route for that is charity. Because charities will bite your hands off for help. Mm-hmm. That could be something as simple like going down to the soup kitchen down the road and dishing out soup once an evening to help homeless people, right?
Yeah.
On the total flip side, on the opposite end of the spectrum, it could be a Team Rubicon UK type of thing,
mm-hmm.
where you're getting trained up for free, you get trained up, you're working with like-minded people, and your role, if you're flipping bleeper, because you get the phone call is, Hugh or Chris, there's been a, well, look at Africa at the minute. Is it Africa?
Mozambique.
Hugh, get your kit ready. If we get the call from Mozambique, we're going. Because they go on invitation today. We're going to go. Are you going to go? Yeah, I'm good to go.
Yeah.
Man, the hairs in the back of your neck stand up.
It's exciting, isn't it?
It's good. Tell me now. Hairs in my neck stand up. Going out. You're on a mission. You're going out. And you're going out. And not only are you just going on a mission, going out to do stuff, you're going out to help people. It's like it's the best thing ever.
It's
best thing ever.
I remember, I think you said in your last podcast, it gave you what was that line you said? It was like, it gave you an opportunity to break out the cry trousers and Aku boots again. And I was that is exactly it.
Yeah, it's really it is,
it's like,
because it's sense of purpose.
Yeah, yeah.
You gotta have it. If you're flipping sitting there, this is the, we're on the couch now with, we're on the Councillor Hugh. If you're flipping sitting there and you just like, I feel like shit. I don't know what I'm doing. I really miss the military. I'm really happy when we speak to the blokes. Or the ladies, it's like, what do I fucking do? Go and just have a think about it, sign up to something and try and get yourself a part of a team with a purpose again.
Yeah.
Team Rubicon may not be the thing for you. It could be something else, but there's opportunities there. Just try it.
Serve on, yeah.
Just try it.
I think to share a Chad quote in like the last couple of minutes, which I know you're obviously run over. this was exactly the problem that I struggled with when I left the BBC. When I left the military, I was like, there's something missing from my life and I can't figure out what it is, but I know it's definitely missing and I'm not getting it in a new broadcasting house. I'm not, you know, I'm getting fat sat there from drinking too many coffees in this place, and it's definitely something that's triggering that. Call it the wanting to be near the pulse of life. And again, I realize it sounds mega Chad, but I think once you spent 10, you know, however many years in the military, and you've been on R1, or you've gone out the door, you've been on ops, or you've gone off and done, you know, even flood responses in the UK as part of the military, is that it's, whilst it feels like you're getting seen off all the time, there's also, it also gives you something which you can talk about and no one else can take it away from you. And it's, I think that's what, me, Team Rubicon gives me back, is like that sense of, not only sense of purpose, but also that excitement of being like, if something happens, I might actually be able to go and do something about this. You know, this happened in 2017 when the Hurricane Irma struck, the Virgin Islands, you know, again, it was like somebody from the Virgin Islands contacted me and I put them in touch with Team Rubicon. And then I was like, fucking hell, why am I passing off to somebody else? Why am I not going out there myself to manage this relationship? And so, you know, again, like 2 days later, was at the airport waiting to fly out to Virgin Islands, you know, and I was like, this is what I miss. This I like, you know, I like this shit, just being out there and doing, you know, interesting things, like being near the pulse of life.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah. Good. Hey. So, well, let's add Chad that is.
That's not on the ball. Chris, been